This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, The Hive by Will Levington Comfort. Foreword. There is much to say. Many have a part in this story of our days. Their work is on the table. Yet no manuscript, no chapter is a real beginning. One must start a book this way, with a fresh sheet in the machine, and tell what he is going to tell about. First of all, it has to do with the unfolding of the child mind. All the stone study work has been for that, but the brimming wonder of it all is that we have chiefly been employed unfolding ourselves. No one can begin upon the sweet and sacred story of life to a child without taking a stride nearer into the center of things and living it. That's what all telling is about, presently to stop talking and to catch up on conduct. The fairest culture of all is to become artists in life. Thinking of this, thinking much upon this one thing, we have been lured out of the heaviness of work into the dimension of play. We tell here about this particular passage. Also, something about the story of man and woman, hinting at what is contained in pages of the Book of Life not opened heretofore for the eyes of the many, but preparing now for the eyes of the children of the new race. A beautiful story, be sure of that, but one that requires art in the telling. No one could bring this story to the lovers and the children of the new race, who had not found out that beauty belongs to the divine trinity with goodness and truth. Many seers have not held that well in mind, many sages have forgotten it, many saints have not learned it adequately at all. We have to build our own heavens here before we can have them anywhere else. The more of an artist a man is, the more reverent he becomes about perfecting his thought forms. Just to mention now, that we rejoice to make much of the beauty side of things in this book, that a thing cannot be beautiful and bad, that beauty is the next quest of the many, as they escape one by one from the bondage of gold. We try to express the soul of things, rather than to delineate boundaries of matter, but a very strong point is made upon the fact that one cannot deal in the spirit until he has mastered to a good degree the coarser stuff that bodies and worlds are made of. We do not care how the young minds aspire mystically, so long as their abutments hold fast in the bottomlands. A man must not drag his anchor as he climbs the hill, he must unfold line all the way, a line made of strands of himself, woven of his own wisdom, love, and power. Much is made in this book of the fact that we are given pounds for a purpose, that all here below is symbol and intimation of a globe and perfection elsewhere. That we cannot look upon the archetype of gold until we have mastered the imitation in clay. We come even closer to this precious subject. For instance, we know that it is only from the soul of things that one can see materials, that no one can get a glimpse of the meaning of materials so long as he is lost in the ruck of them. At the same time, we do not believe that we have access, even to the lesser grades of mysticism, until we have all the power and force of the material-minded. We believe we must do well that which the world is doing, even the tasks of the average man, that nothing can be missed. We do not encourage that mystic or poet who requires endowment. If we are to be artists, we believe in supporting our own groups. We have a suspicion that we are not through with conditions, any conditions no matter how hateful, so long as they have us whipped. We aspire to be writers and politicians and painters and heroes. We aspire to be masters in all the superb productions of life, but we are content to begin with the ground. We are content with poverty, yet we believe that very early as workmen, we are entitled to a fastidious poverty, which is expensive. No possessions, but all possessions. As writers, we are convinced that it is necessary to do, and inimitably well, the things that the public wants and pays 10 cents the word for, quite as well as to reveal the deeper folds of our growth for which we have to finance publication. We are not sure yet which is the worthier achievement. Perhaps we speak much of soul in this book, but we mean nothing more formidable than the better part of every man. This is the big fellow who takes us over when we do that which is worthwhile, in billiards or diplomacy, in art or love or trade. I think it is the big comrade which we are really unfolding, the workman and player. Much of soul we write because it is the point of our educational drive, to set it free in the child or the young workman, to make it speak or write or play and not mere brain and hand. We speak much of love, not as an emotion, not as a sentiment, but as a cosmic force. You will see much more what we mean by this as you turn the pages. It is the most challenging thing in the world. It is the inner white-hot core of the fatherland that is to be, the great white democracy of the future. Democracy, that's the point of inception of it all, that word is the seed. The more you dwell upon it, you know what the seamless robe of the Christ means, the more you realize that the Master Jesus was the first big Democrat. We have them speak the word softly and thoughtfully here each day. We like to hear the young ones say it. They are apt to know as much about it as you do, for the word doesn't mean exactly what they mean, who have used it most heretofore. It isn't the name of a political party, yet. It is government of the people by the people, but only to those who see the sons of God in the eyes of passing men. We only ask its magic, not its presence upon these pages. They're fighting for it gloriously, every hour. The boys here thrill with the boys there. We hold our hands high to them. Some of our boys are there. They are all our boys. Some are waiting the call to go, but there or here, we are pulling together for the real fatherland, for the adequate fraternity, under the endless and thrilling magic of the word equality. I can say no more splendid word to you than my equal. I know of no greater adventure than to become one of the many. It is true that you and I, the best of us, the immortal within us each, are of one house, that this is but a far outpost of the journey, Egypt if you like, the husks if you like, but that we have arisen and are on our way home to the Father's house. Canyon, Santa Monica, California. End of the foreword. Chapter 1, North Americans. The thing called the new race, the passion of poets, the phantom running ahead, and forever calling the dreamer and revolutionist and occultist, is far from a reality as yet among the commonplaces of the world. It is the spirit of everything worthwhile, but that means nothing to one who has not a breath of it in his own body. A story went forth from this shop recently, in which certain ideals and presences of the new social order were carried through to a cheerful ending. The publisher wrote, "Yes, but what is the new race?" It's a fair question, but remember one cannot adequately describe a spiritual thing in terms of matter. It is only possible of portrayal, where it has broken through into terms of three space. First, you are apt to get the nearest and most striking picture of the new race at your own supper table, the presence of one of your own children, especially if the young one is hard to understand. Parents and children of all times have found confusion and alarm in each other's ways. But there are rare periods of human history when the difference between two generations has been not a normal and superficial crack, but an abyss. It is so now. The old has reached its climacteric point of destructivity. All self-passions destroy themselves in time. Fear, greed, sensuality, all are self-destructive. Great human numbers and decadent principles have been recently broken down in the world with a swiftness and abandonment, heretofore unrecorded, except in the traditions of planetary flood and flame. You may watch closely the child under 7 who plays in the unseen, whose companions are not in the room for older eyes, watch the one of fancies and fairies and fragrances which others cannot quite discern. Many a child has been driven with a soul wound into corroding silence by parents who thought they were punishing falsehood, when they were in reality repressing the imagination, the faculty which master artists denote as the first and loveliest possession of the creative mind. Too coarse and unlit to see what the child saw, the parents again and again have looked gravely at each other, saying, "This is a crisis. Our child has begun to lie. We must forget her own feelings and punish her." So often it is her, but not always. The boys who are to do the great tasks of song and prophecy and architecture, they too dream dreams and see visions and have the rapt eyes of Joan in the forests of Domremy, They too are severely questioned by the Pharisees. None escape this scourging. They too, in many cases, shall be put to death. The new ideals of the parenthood, education, romance, are now being introduced and promulgated by pioneers long since emerged from the old litter and humus. Education will mean, first of all, a turning for power to the unseen. The quest of the swan and the star and the beloved are never carried along on the levels and inequalities of the earth, always the uplifted face for the saint and the sage and the seer. Great parents kneel beside their children and beg to be delivered from the heaviness which holds them to the dim shadows, where the child sees face to face. Education will mean finding his intrinsic task for the child, the intensive cultivation of the human spirit from the soul outward, not alone from the brain inward. The quest of the passing age was for gold. The real meaning and symbol and glory of gold, as the highest, smoothest, and most finished of minerals, has been lost in the bulkier products and possessions it meant to measure and signify. More and more has gold itself hid away from vulgar hands and been represented by objects intrinsically inferior. We now behold a civilization destroying itself for commodities and destroying the commodities for which the destruction began. Gold itself will serve beauty in the coming age. Commerce will serve aesthetics. The lovers of beauty begin with the sand, with the clay. They love nature from the ground up. They are fervent for light and air, for sun and sky and water, for fruits and grains and bees, for stars and rains and romances. They say such things are holy. Words are inadequate for their loves and appreciations. They find the ways to love God infinite. They see him in stone and stream. They see him in the eyes of the deep-down men. They see him risen and inevitable in the eyes of their lovers. Straight goodness will not do for the new race, nor straight intellectuality. Artists, singers, painters, and idealists will be the heroes of the generations to come, for they will add the quest of beauty to the unwashed goodness of the saints and pilgrims. These are bit flaring points. One is embarrassed in short space because of a myriad things to say. Free verse is a sign of the new, also the dream of a free world and the planetary patriotism. The imminence of the spirit of all things is a sign, the sense of the underlying oneness of humanity, not alone the fatherland, but the kinderland where new fountains are established and sages and masters come for inspiration. All these like a passing train of wonder, a glimpse of many cars. I think I can bring the picture in closer by using a few pages of work from one of the young men with me. His name is Steve. I called him the Dakotan in the book, Child and Country. We've romped and ridden together for 3 years, and I've known Steve better every day, still far from the end. The rest of the chapter is Steve's writing. North Americans. Out of the centuries of moil and mix and fuse of Europe, the Orient and the North countries, a gleaming archetype has emerged here which may be called the real North Americans. They are scattered here and there among the younger generation, young people new in name only, in soul they are as old as Zeus. Often they are strangers in their father's house. They blend the mind of the Occidental with the soul of the East, splendid firstlings of an untried future. They betray themselves by their genius. Heredity is the first fetish overthrown by them. From the first they are a law unto themselves. They cast off churches, codes, creeds, schools, and parents as preliminary steps in their teens. In the 20s they are prodigies, leaders in the arts or the revolutions. It is their aim to overreach themselves, not to further a type. Very early they conjure together in secret and obscure places, revolting against life as it is lived, like a handful of white dwellers in a foreign city. There is always an alien, intangible something about these people. One senses the double life they lead, their own and others. Conditions are not yet adjusted for them. They are supranationalists, the first mark of the new. They are dreamers who make their dreams come true in matter, and first among their dreams is of the planet in one piece. They are naturally intolerant of barriers and partitions. They see ahead a new social order, vast and shining as a devachanic vision, the real democracy of the future. They see that the new has come in not to kill, but to build. Theirs will be the spiritual heroics. Yet all this, of the greater patriotism, must not yet be spoken. It only alienates them the more from those they must live with. Their arch enemy is ignorance, personified so often in their elders. It is noticeable that these young people are healthier, stronger, swifter, sharper, tougher, bolder, and at the same time lighter and finer than the passing generation. They have the new healthiness. They belong to the open, and are practically immune to disease. Theirs is the health of sun and wind and spirit, vitality instead of constitution, something the old can never understand. Constitution is weight, solid, ungiving. Vitality is volatile, springy, electric, constantly being given, constantly being acquired, self-refining. Constitution does not change, it accumulates all it can, then begins to die. The young women of this new race are open, strong, eye-to-eye, free-spoken. They are capable of friendships, they are not adverse to being wholly understood by males. They are not popular with ordinary women, who surmise their superiority, but comprehend it not. Deceit, jealousy, and such common disturbances evident in the sex are unknown to them. They have character, and are lovely rather than beautiful. They are apt to go halfway in their lovemaking, for who should know better when the chosen father of their children arrives? All of these people are bringers of true love. Love is their philosophy and religion. They listen to the heart as well as the brain. Others think them cruel in their discrimination in mating. They take all or nothing, prodigious riskers, great sufferers, throwing even love's dream on the board to be played for and laughing as they play. The slightest blight on the loved one is deepest agony. Perhaps the surest way of discovering these young giants is to search about for the most sorely harassed children. Invariably they are put to it, to break into this day and generation. They fight their way up through all the banked-up ignorance and antagonism of unlit humanity. Often they are solitaires, coming and going with the secrecy of kings and eagles. End of the chapter. Chapter 2, Quickenings. A few pages of drift, first of all, with the younger boys. There is a lane of Lombardy poplars from the lake to the interurban car line, a half mile. It is a lifting walk at any time, but summer evenings are wonderful with all the sounds and scents of a true pastoral, lake breath and meadowlands, the whole sky to look at, and the murmuring dissonance of the poplars. Often we walk to the car with passing guests. One evening a guest went away whom we loved very much. A lad of 7, named John, and I walked back from the car alone. He was ignited. I felt this at last through his hand. I had been thinking about my own things all too long, missing the beginnings of his talk. He hurried forward in the dusk, speaking in a hushed, rapt voice. Because I had missed the first part, I said, "John, I want you to write that, either tonight or tomorrow." And this is what came in. The Magic Lane. It was at dusk. Two people left their tracks in nature's dust road. Love is found on that road. It is the road of the mystics. They leave their love in it, nature kisses their feet. Many horses' feet have been kissed on that mystic road. That mystic road will last forever. I long to walk upon that road of love. Love on that road will last forever. It is all true love. Our friends have been met on that road of love. It leads to the hills of God. Certain spelling matters have been corrected. We pay little attention to spelling in the work here. The young ones learn by reading and get the proper look of a word altogether too soon in many cases. There was another high moment from John at the same time. The following three lines have stood out from the period with memorable magic. Wonder. The soft breath of the mother came in through the window of vines. The stars were shining like the face of the new generation. My spirit was away in the hills. A noise at the door brought me back. John then fell into a psychological tangle which we found little profit in following. By the mother, he referred to nature. The verse period has passed for the time. Around the age of 7, boys change. Often, as in this case, they are not so interesting for a while afterward. John is coming 9 now, and is writing action stories with all the worn and regulation props and settings. The early tendency will return with a dimension added. All transitions are times of disorder, but they are followed by larger areas and truer fulfillments of order. A cloud falls upon the sanctuary, but when it is dispelled, one perceives a lifted dome, bright with its new cloth of gold. I am struck every day in dealing with young boys how wisdom and beauty and truth can be inculcated in their lives, without pain and strain to them, and with great profit to the teacher. The young mind is quick to change. It has not grown its ferrocycle ivory. The sanction of a boy must be won on a physical basis. A man must know what the boy knows and go him one better. The man must understand boy points of view, but never expect the boy to be puerile. Parents of the past generations have had the steady effrontery to expect very little from children. Why, they are only children, has done more to make for vacuousness and drivel than any other visionless point of view, none of which has been missed. There is a difference in ages, to be sure. The child's mind has not masked for use the external impacts of 20 or 30 years of life in the world, but there is also an immortal within, a singer, hero, builder, or a teacher possibly, eager to manifest through the child's fresh mind, fervid to bring the mind of the child to its subjection for the expression of its own revelations. Indeed, the parents themselves are enjoined to become as little children. In arriving at this wisdom and humility, they may suddenly find masters in their own children. There is also a lad here of 7 named Tom. Yesterday I found him beside me on the sand, down by the water's edge. I began to tell him about the inner light that we all carry. You can talk over a child's head if your words are choked with mental complications, which is apt to be second-rate talk anyway, but you seldom are out of reach of a fine child's grasp when you speak of spiritual things. He was sitting cross-legged, folded hands between his knees, a little six-pointed star, head and shoulders the three upper points, knees with folded hands between the three lower. He was bare from the waist up and thighs down, and brown as the honey of buckwheat. I told him that the 7th and perfect point of his star was within, that if he shut his eyes and kept very still, putting away for the present all his thoughts about himself, his feelings, his wants and his rights, looking into himself, as one would look ahead for a lamp in the night, listening deep within, as one would listen for the voice of a loved friend, I promised that at last he would see what the three wise men saw, the star in the east. He need only follow that star, and be true to its guidance to come at last to the cave and the solar babe. After that I hinted that I would come to his feet and listen. Tom felt that it was worth trying for at once, shut his eyes, turning all thoughts and gaze within. He held the posture long. I have marveled again and again at the quickness with which the child mind attains to concentration, so essential for all original production. The little ones have no mad emotional lists to sort out and subdue. Their wants are simple yes and no in so many cases. Indeed, they are spared the struggle of becoming as little children. Tom held the posture, until I was actually tense from the strain of waiting and keeping my thoughts from calling his. It was a picture: sun-whitened hair, long yellow lashes, brown body with a bit of babe softness left to it, and glorious sunlight. He opened his eyes at last, saying that he had the door where the light was, almost opened, when a fly bit him. I thought of the perfection of the instance of the mind's waywardness, the coming of the master spoiled by a fly bite. Tom will search for his star every day. It is strange that he is closer to the hill pastures around Bethlehem, under 7, than for years afterward. To learn concentration in midlife after the world has been put through a man is an ordeal at best, and yet we are by no means masters of ourselves, nor capable of significant achievement, until the brain can be stilled at will of its petty affairs, the first aim of concentration, and becomes the glad servant of the giant within. A little later, I saw Tom on the back of a huge black walk-trot saddle horse of show quality, passing up the lane at a fast clip, his feet halfway to the stirrups, holding on to the saddle with one hand, the bridle rein in the other. A year or two ago, I should have been afraid to permit that, but we manage now to relieve the young ones of a large part of our fears for their welfare. Children have enough to overcome from their parents. Frequently, the New Age young people have to master their heredity before they begin upon themselves. Life is a big horse to ride, so often a black horse. It is well to start children free and unafraid. We do not let them dwell in thought of pain. We do not permit tears. We inform them early that to be sick is a confession of uncleanness, that lying is for the use of cowards only, and that to be cruel marks the idiot. We are occasionally serious over repeated failures, but we laugh over things done well. Tennis has unfolded marvelous possibilities in the training of will force. Children are shown that there is a mystic quality to all the perfect games, that the great billiardists and tennis and baseball players perform feats in higher space, whether they know it or not. There is the essential ideal, first in the making of the athlete, as in the making of the poet. The great moments of play require faculties swifter and more unerring than the human eye or hand or mind. Ask the master of any game if he had time to think in pulling off the stroke that won. It is inspiration that he uses quite the same as the poet in his high moments. Education is the preparation of the mind to receive and answer to inspiration from a plane above. The more you develop merely the brain of a child, the more he is detached from the great principles of being, the more also is he closed to the real and subjected to the danger of actual lesion and sickness. The more you develop the spirit of a child, or rather give the significant one within an opportunity to come forth and be the child, the more you make for beauty, health, goodness, and glory of bodily life. A lucky day when you start really to associate with your children, luckier still when you undertake the work of teaching them incidental to your own work. Then and there, you begin to realize that children are close to a source of things that you cannot touch. Presently you realize that they are teaching you. Day after day, I have studied and practiced the development of the child from within outward. I have seen the capacity to synthesize and assimilate mere mental matters developed in a year, by training the mind from the center of origins outward, that mental training alone could never accomplish. The mind itself becomes vigorous and avid, and capacious and majestically swift. It is trained to express its true self. That is power, that is king play. This sentence covers the whole matter. The perfect way to develop the mind of the child is to teach him to sit and listen at the feet of his own master, the soul. The right to live, and to bring the laughter of power to the days, must be won afresh each morning. No 2 days alike. We make ourselves impossible to children of the New Age by trying to confine them in the laws and rules of yesterday. The young people whom I serve live in a different intensity. Their interest flags if I repeat, if I fall into familiar rhythms. Continually they spur me on. I think, after all, great teaching is the capacity to feel what the younger minds are thinking. If we are too coarse to catch the first warning of their resistance, they slip farther and farther from our grasp. It would not seem possible to hold American young people with spiritual affairs, yet this is done daily. We call the unseen the great gamble. I have shown how all else betrays, how all matter is a mockery at the last, that even love and friendship fail for those who are called to weep and worship wholly at the tomb of the body. The truth is out. The beginnings of real teaching is in making the unseen interesting and dramatic. We dwell upon the mystic white lines which connect all things, the sources of daring and beauty and creativeness. I ask my young people where they were, when they did any rare and improved bit of work, when they felt like great comrades, met some magnanimous impulse, arose to superb instance of play, or when in chapel the big animation touched us all and set us free. They always answer that they were out of themselves. That's a secret of the new teaching again, to lift the students out of themselves. Men take to drink or drugs for this same reason. Men and women set out on the great adventure.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.